In this lesson, we're going to discuss gradient boosting. The goals are to learn about gradient boosting, a method that fits complicated models by refitting submodels, typically decision trees, to either residuals or pseudo-residuals. Gradient boosting can be used with classification or regression problems. We also perform some example analysis using gradient boosting. What is gradient boosting? It is one of the so-called ensemble methods. The ensemble methods came in two major categories: Bagging-inspired classifiers and regressors, such as random forest, which control generalization error through perturbation and refitting and averaging of submodels, usually decision trees, and boosting-inspired classifiers, which fit complex models by iteratively refitting submodels, again, usually decision trees, to residuals. Our first model, which is just one tree, gives the following fit. The black line with dots is the actual data to be fit. The blue dots are the predictions made by the model, and the red lines represent the residuals. Obviously, long red lines are large errors. Once the gradient boosting moves on to two trees, you get a better model, which is given by this set of blue dots. We are showing the previous model as green dots, and we can see the new model has split the right-hand side into two regions and moved things around a bit to improve the fit. With three trees, we get another moderate improvement, again splitting things up to the right and readjusting levels. The gradient-boosted model with 100 trees is starting to look like a ragged copy of the sine wave. To use gradient-boosting for classification, we need to define what are residuals on a classification problem. Gradient-boosting uses a concept called a pseudo-gradient of the for its residuals. The gradient is a direction of quickest improvement. The pseudo-gradient, in general, is the derivative of a loss function L, where L is any criticism of a given data yi against a fit f of xi. For classification, we can pick the loss function L to be the deviance, and then the gradient of the deviance gives us a notion of pseudo-residuals, our directions to fit. A sublearner, often a decision tree, is picked to be as close as possible to the current pseudo-gradient, i.e., we're picking the sublearner to be an improvement in the direction we consider the best way to improve the current overall loss function. What is going on? As we've said, the algorithm is iterative, like GAMS. It starts building sums of more and more sublearners. At each stage, we're looking for a sublearner that most improves the current fit. Roughly, this means it greatly improves the examples we're currently very wrong on and doesn't mess up too much on the current examples. At each stage, the objective is different, i.e., the objective is given by current residuals, not the original training data, so we expect to find different sublearners at trees at each step. Gradient boosting has shrinkage and regularization built in. These are properties that make it more likely a good model on training will be a good model on test or new data. Regularization, which we've already seen in this course, usually means an optimization control that trains quality of fit on training data against model simplicity, model simplicity often being something like coefficient size or number of wiggles in the model. The idea is that this trade-off tends to improve generalization error. Gradient boosting's regularization controls are tree depth and complexity, number of trees in the model, and some variants also regularize the coefficients using L1, L2 style regularization. The tree depth, complexity, and coefficient controls are all very strong. The number of trees control is not compelling to me, as it looks a lot like Adaboost's claimed early exit regularization, which I found not to be that useful in practice. Some authors suggest running gradient boosting or any ensemble model, picking the sublearners, and then picking a whole new set of coefficients independent of the model's execution history using standard regularization techniques. This is treating the ensemble as a new set of features to be learned over. Shrinkage is a technique to improve an estimator by averaging the estimator with a simpler estimator that is less informed about or may not even have looked at the training data at hand. There's lots of controversy about shrinkage and what it means. It leads to issues like Stein's paradox and strange estimators such as Stein's estimator. It may be easier to roughly think of shrinkage in Bayesian terms as attempting to place in a prior or attempting to place in a different uninformative prior than the standard one. Gradient boosting shrinkage is controlled by a learning rate, which controls how much the latest tree is averaged into the current ensemble. This is an old trick from the days of perceptron learning, mistake-bounded learning, and backpropagation learning. It is not clear to me this method of shrinkage is in fact as strong as the full statistical concept, but it is very useful. That being said, gradient boosting is a good algorithm. I prefer it to data reweighting boosting algorithms such as the original AdaBoost. Gradient boosting may be a good way to find important interactions after accounting for strong signals that it may have originally been hiding them. Let's try some real examples. Let's work through an example gradient boost analysis in R. We're going to use a pre-supplied knitter document, which we'll supply as part of the course extras. To start, we're going to load the data. The data is the isolet data set from the UCI machine learning repository. It is a number of spoken letters, and we're going to try to differentiate the letter N from the spoken letter M, a hard task even for people. We'll load some of our helper functions. And we'll get on to the GBM fitting. In R, GBM has two calling methods, the GBM through the formula interface and the faster GBM through the frame or matrix interface. It has a number of options, including the shrinkage control, which attempts to control for generalization error, though we find this default value is often way too low. It's also important to note, if you mess with the train fraction, you must have your data in a scrambled order, because the fraction of data you're reserving for various training purposes is the initial segment, and you don't want that to have unintentional structure. The call we're going to use is the following. We've specified our variables through the formula. We're training only on the subset of our data that is not test. We've specified the Bernoulli control to say it's a classification problem. We've told the GBM to try to set up to 400 trees with an interaction depth of 3, so it can try to find relations among groups of variables. We've set the shrinkage factor to a higher number, as we've said. And we've also set the cross-validation folds to 5, which gives some interesting extra features in the GBM fit. We're going to ignore the warning messages and go on. We're going to call this GBM perf on the GBM model object, which tells us how many trees we should use instead of the 400 we asked for. It says it considers 264 trees a good model. The reason is due to the following graph. The black line is the performance of the training data of a subset of the training data used while fitting GBM. The green line is out-of-sample performance of another subset of the training data. And as you see, as the number of trees goes up, which is what's the iteration number on the x-axis, training performance continues to improve. The error rate continues to go down as you continue to add trees, though obviously you're hitting diminishing returns. However, the test performance or out-of-sample performance stops improving, and we sometimes see this arc up. And the GBM software has picked, with this dotted blue line, the number of trees it suggests using in application, which is 264. GBM also has a number of good summary functions. This is much more legible when you have fewer variables. The isolate system has around 500-600 variables, but it's building a data frame of the variables sorted in relative importance, that V298 was the feature most useful to the model. And you can use this for later variable pruning and reruns. Of course, we're most interested in the predictions. We'll go through our standard set of reports, which are explained in the Evaluating Models lecture. But the important thing to look for in this lesson is just one summary. We're going to ignore the rest of the graphs. The double density plot of GBM on test. And this is almost an ideal plot. The red line is the distribution of model predictions, so the x-axis is the model prediction, and the red group is the group of data known to be not in the class, and it is concentrated mostly on the left, as you would like, and the blue or teal line is concentrated mostly on the right, showing very good separation. In fact, the GBM trained up perfectly on training data and explained 98% of the variation on training data, had an accuracy of 89% on test data, and explained 67% of the variation on test. So we have some degree of overfitting, but it's not overfitting we're blind to. We controlled for it during the model complexity selection, or selecting how many trees iterations we allow into our final model. And this set of controls is fairly typical of boosting-derived algorithms. We could also perform the same analysis in Python using the Pandas data manipulation libraries and the scikit-learn machine learning libraries. We'll demonstrate this analysis as an IPython worksheet, which is an interactive worksheet that has a lot of the powers of Knitter. We're going to show this sheet in batch format to make things fast. We'll use R to do our plotting. Therefore, we'll load the RPy2 extension into IPython. In Python itself, we would then load all the libraries required to do the operation. The data is loaded quite easily using Pandas CSV readers, which also can read compressed data directly. We specify which column we're trying to classify. In this case, it's 617, because Python numbers columns from 0 instead of from 1, as R does. And we check the dimensions of our data after limiting down to data that was just M and N, the 13th and 14th letters in the alphabet. To build a model, we call scikit-learn ensemble gradient boosting classifier. We first instantiate the classifier, and then we fit the model to data. We've taken the care to convert the data from the Pandas format, which is a lot like an R data frame, oriented in terms of series or columns, into just a simple row-oriented data matrix. We then apply the model and go. We then, in an R block, the %R in IPython says this language of this block is R, load the exact same standard plotting packages we used before. Now, to perform the analysis of the fit and true values, we start up a new R block, tell it to import the variables predictions on training, Y variable on training, predictions on test, Y variable on test. We then build a data frame holding these values by building a training data frame and a test data frame, and R binding these two data frames into one frame with all the rows. And then we call our standard R report library. And we get essentially the same results in terms of accuracy, variation explained on both test and training. And the graphs are very similar. The double density plot seems to have a bit more of the negative class strongly concentrated than the R one did. ROC plots cover most of the area, meaning the classifier is high of quality, and the gain plots, the model prediction very much is near the wizard prediction, saying that it's a pretty good classifier. We'll supply this IPython notebook as part of the course extras. What you should take away: gradient boosting is a good package black box classifier. As you see, it was fairly simple to run. Its main purpose is to learn complicated relations and interactions by adding sublearners. These interactions and shapes may not have been obvious before other larger trends are removed, and that is what gradient boosting does during its iterative fitting. Consider it a complement method to random forest. Random forest very much optimizes generalization error, and gradient boosting very much optimizes model complexity.